I think Jamie was pretty fascinated that, I hope that's the right word, but was fascinated by the fact that I had started with John Carpenter. And John Carpenter, I ended up starting with him on a picture called Big Trouble in Little China, which while we were doing it, I came in as the co-editor, the second editor, but I started at the beginning. There was an editor named Mark Warner who I had worked with, who asked me to come on and co-edit with him. And it was a Fox picture, it was John Carpenter, you know, and I really liked John Carpenter movies. I had a couple of favorites at that point, you know. And so when I started working on it, I thought, this is the oddest movie I've ever worked on, you know. And I was very young. I think I was pretty young when I did that. I think it was like in 86 or I'm guessing it was around there. I felt like it was pretty early on in my editing career. I edited my first picture at 29 after I had my 8 years in, and I had to be early 30s when I cut that. I was probably 32, 33 years old. But then John and I ended up cutting his next picture called Prince of Darkness, which was more in the vein of what I was used to with Carpenter versus Big Trouble in Little China. And then when I finished up on that one, I went on and did a picture called Spellbinder, and that Janet Greek was directing. And John, I got a call from Larry Franco, who's John's producer, and said, "Hey, John needs your help," you know. And I said, "Well, I'm cutting a movie," you know. And he says, "Ah, you owe him. You really, you know." Larry could talk anybody into anything, you know. And he says, "You got to just talk to your producer and director." I said, "Well, what do you want me to do? I'm on another movie." Editors aren't like maybe some other professions where, you know, as a composer, I can do six movies at once, or as a post super, I can do a half a dozen movies and keep my eyes on it. You do one picture at a time as an editor. It's all encompassing. And so Janet was married to Joe Wazan, who was a producer at the time. And they were just getting ready to go to Europe. So I said, "Look, John needs my help. And he's doing this picture called They Live. And you're going to Europe. We've already turned over to sound effects. Would it be okay with you if I took 2 weeks away and just helped him?" He wants me to... John wanted me to come in and do all the fight scenes in They Live. Whoever was editing the picture was, you know, too busy with the other parts of the picture, and John felt they needed to be punched up. So I said sure, and I went over and I cut the fight scenes for about 2 weeks. It ended up being like the longest fight scene in the history of the alley scene, where it was just a big punch out with Roddy Piper, I think, you know. But I had fun on that picture, and then I went back and finished Spellbinder. And then John and I were gonna do another picture that ended up just getting canceled, and we fell out of sync, and that was that. I feel like you learn something on every film. I've never been on a film I didn't walk away going, "Wow, you know, that was great." So in respect to, you know, I grew up, when I was at Warner Brothers, The Exorcist was kind of a big deal, you know. I was just starting in editing and going to studio, sneaking into studio screenings of The Exorcist and then Clockwork Orange, which, anything that was just off, you know. And I loved the whole idea of, you know, being part of that whole process. I didn't realize as an apprentice and an assistant and somebody starting out just how involved an editor was. And but I thought that most people I met in editing were pretty cool, and that was the place I wanted to be, because they didn't have to get up early, you know. So that was a big deal. One thing I love about working in the horror genre is that there's that instant gratification and reaction you get from audiences. It's really hard for them to hide terror or fright or humor, or, you know, sometimes it can be very scary, but it can be very reactive, really funny at the same time, you know. Somebody's walking up a flight of stairs, everybody in the audience immediately says, "Don't do that," but you know they're gonna do it anyway. So it is a lot of fun to get that kind of emotion instantly out of an audience. You know, when people are scared, it's fun. It's just fun. It's fun to scare people. You do it as kids, right? You wait around a corner for your sister to come around and you'll boo, and you'd love to see her jump. I just finished I Know What You Did Last Summer, I think. You know, you do pictures and then sometimes they hold them and they release after you've done another picture. But I had done a couple of pictures. I was coming off of, I think I'd already done Broken Arrow, and I think I'd already done Con Air. And, you know, I was just rolling from picture to picture, and it was just great fun. I liked the idea of doing it because, you know, I knew Frank Uriosity over at Warner's. I knew it was a Warner's picture. I started in the mailroom at Warner Brothers when I was a teenager, basically. And so it was an opportunity to get back there. I had done a picture or two up in Vancouver, and so it was an opportunity to go back to a place that I liked, and I'd heard great things about Jamie, and so yeah, there was no downside, you know. Well, we didn't actually meet before we met in person up in Vancouver. We had talked on the phone. It was, you know, and so it, you know, it's, he hired me before I actually met him. Silly him, right? It was about reputation and what I'd done before, and you know, we had at least a couple of phone conversations, and he's very easy to talk to. You know, couldn't understand the accent at all, but it was what I did understand. It was good, you know. And when we did finally meet up in Vancouver, it was just like we'd been buddies forever. We really took a liking to each other. It was very comfortable. One thing about working with Jamie that is just, you know, it's maybe this is why we've remained friends and strong friends for so many years, is that he understood the editing process. He was very respectful of it. Easy, collaborative, you know, always listening to people's ideas. He didn't always take your ideas, but he listened to them and made you feel like you had a valuable, you're in a position where your opinion was valued, you know. So, and, you know, as an editor, you can't ask for anything else. As any filmmaker, you want to be brought in and given the opportunity to bring something to the game. And I had done quite a few pictures by then, but this was 20 years ago. And so I still had a fair resume for a relatively young editor at the time. And it was great. I felt like I could, you know, kind of bring something to the game with him, so it's good. My MO, and I'm pretty sure this is what happened with Jamie, is after we read the script and we go through it, and I may have some questions about, you know, how are you planning on covering this, and he may say, hey, I'm thinking of doing this, I can do it in 3 shots, what do you think? And maybe we'll sit and figure out a way with Rick Boda, who is the DP, how to do it in 2 shots. There's always communication between the director and the editor when I work, especially if you're on location together. If there's a big time difference, it gets to be harder to do, you know, because I'm usually in the rear view then. But when you're on location, there's a lot of communication about, as soon as I get the dailies in the morning, he shoots today on Monday. And after he shoots on Monday, I get the film Tuesday morning, my crew does. And they start putting it together and syncing it as quickly as possible. And early in the day, you know, very early in the day, I'm looking at dailies myself. I don't leave that as a chore or a task for my assistants because I need to start getting first impressions right away. So I take my own notes. I still do it today. I did it back then. I'm a pencil and paper guy. I sit, and once I've imprinted it on a page, I usually don't have to look at it again because it stays, you know. So I'll go ahead and I'll go through the picture. I'll pick up the phone. I'll let Jamie know, in this case, how he did, what we got. You know, I'll ask him if he had preferences that were strong. He usually had some ideas, and, you know, he would share them with me. It was never like, you need to use this or you need to use that. But, you know, you want to bring it's the director's picture. You want to bring his vision to the screen in the most interesting way you can. So you always look at the preferences in terms of performance that grab the director on the spot, and you try to work those in, if you can. If you can't, you don't get hung up on it and make it affect the way the rest of the scene's going to go together. So, you know, then we have conversations after that about if he needs something, if he needs to pick something up. And it's not just that, gee, I'd like to get this. You have to be able to say why. You have to have a reason for everything you do, because you need to validate it, and you have to think things through. So that's the process for me, usually in the mornings. with Jamie, because a lot of times we would look at daily, I think we looked at dailies just about every day together. I would concentrate on what his thoughts were. I'd like to see if while we were running dailies, he smirked about something or dreaded something. And, you know, I concentrate a lot on how he feels, which is the same thing we do in a preview audience. I try to look at the audience and what they react to. I've seen it. I know what I want to do. And now I want to know what he wants to do. And sometimes it's not a vocalization. Sometimes it's just his reaction, you know, whether it's putting his hand over his head or, or, you know, being very excited about what he just saw. So, but it's very collaborative. And then I go to work. When he goes to work, I go to work, and I'm cutting what he shot yesterday. Theoretically, if you're that fast, and I'm not saying I am, you know, eventually you get behind. But, you know, it's a pretty collaborative process. And I like to try to, at the end of a week, I like to sit Jamie down and I like to run for him what I did that week. I think he needs to see how things are working and how his instincts are in terms of shooting and then what he sees cut. And it also helps me because if I'm way off, I want to know early on. Plus, once I hit a first cut, which is usually a couple weeks after they wrap, it gives the director an opportunity to take a deep breath, go relax somewhere for a week or so, collect his thoughts, get a little objectivity back in just a couple of weeks, and then we sit down together and we start at the beginning and we work our way through and we laugh a lot and we try things. You have to try everything. There's no bad ideas. Some work better than others, that's all. You know, so it gets to be, you have to just keep in mind that we make hundreds of decisions a day, some on our own and some together. And that's the pleasure of the job. I mean, we find things that we didn't count on or we didn't think would work this way on a daily basis. I mean, there's always something. I mean, it's a constant state of flux. You are always changing things. You're never done until they just grab it out of your hands and run away with it, you know. I mean, it's not that you don't get tired of doing the same, you know, let's make another hit, let's make a new approach. You don't get tired of it. You just keep going until they say stop it, you know, because there's always a way, yeah. With Valentine and like with most films that I edit, whether it's the relationship that I have with the director, whether it's intuitive, without meaning to sound arrogant, my first cuts, I believe, I don't call them assemblies. I get pretty insulted when producers or people refer to my cuts as, well, it's an assembly. And I go like, what do you mean? You know, I put a lot of work into them and I feel like I'm about 80% usually by the time I run a first cut. And that's why it's so much fun. And that's why you can really narrow your focus and sit and really just beat the heck out of these scenes. And you know, because there's always time elements. You're always trying to get time out, or, you know, you're trying to get these posturing moments out that, you know, you just can't do on your first cut. It's an evolutionary, the process. You end up at E or F, but you have to start at A and you have to go through B, C, D, and E. You just can't go from A to F. You just can't do it. I can't. I'm not that good. It just all seemed to flow very naturally from the time we started. I feel like we followed the script pretty close. I just looked at the picture again a few days ago, and I've done quite a few pictures since I did that one, maybe 20 or 30, I don't know. But, you know, filmmaking changes and trends change, and, you know, I thought that the picture worked on a lot of levels. There are still some really scary moments in that. I mean, I hadn't revisited the film for quite a few years, and when I saw the execution by Cupid's arrow, that was awesome. It was like, woof, you know, three arrows, you know, and then over the rail and into the trash can. And the funny thing is that I had another film I had done. Well, it was Friday the 13th, where there was a boxing scene where after the kid who was a boxer took quite a few shots at our masked hero, he took one swing and took the kid's head off, and it bounced off a building and into a trash can, which was pretty funny. So I had forgotten that. I think there is an increasing pace because, you know, And I believe it's due to video games. It's due to just the sophistication. Audiences, you know, you want to think that kids get smarter and that people get smarter and that things advance and move ahead. And, you know, but I still think, you know, I was looking for, when I watch a picture that I haven't done in a while, I do it with real cautious optimism that I'm not going to look at a picture that looks like I could drive semi-trucks through the transitions in the scenes. I go, what was I thinking, you know? And generally, you know, the pace on Valentine is pretty good still, you know? I mean, I didn't really think it felt slow. But there's a different indulgence now, you know? I mean, there's some pretty violent scenes in Valentine, but they also almost felt like they had a governor on them. You know, like the drill a bit into the, that was horrible. I mean, that's a really terrifying scene. It's terrifying enough being locked in a hot tub or a jacuzzi, but then to have a giant drill bit come through, it's like, and then to be electrocuted, it's like the triple whammy, you know? It's like, here, you like that? Try this. You know, now it seems like, depending on the audience, audiences want more violence on R-rated violent films. If you try to do it more tastefully, you know, which I think is harder to do because you have to think about it a little more. You're not cutting somebody's arm off, you know, which audiences want to see. I mean, the whole Saw, you know, I mean, everything that's bloody, it's got to be bloody, bloody, bloody. Right now, I think you have to be a little smarter about how you scare people, you know. There's a way of building up the terror, which I think we did in Valentine. You can build it up and deliver a good scare without getting gratuitous, you know. Some of our, you know, although I must say a hatchet in the back is a little on the gratuitous side, isn't it? But he deserved it, you know. He definitely deserved it. I love the little speed dating sequence. That was fun. Just because it got you out of somebody's house and into like the real world where they were just being girls that wanted to get dates, you know. And the guys were also, they were jerks. They were just jerks. I was looking for a polite word, but they were. I mean, it was, you know, the whole, it's fun because, you know, you need to release that tension that you've built up in prior scenes. Or you need to just lighten the mood so that you can actually hit somebody in the gut in the next scene, you know. That was a fun scene. The killings are great, you know. I mean, those are always fun. I don't look at things as challenging. I just, you know, just some sequences I like better than others. You know, whether or not we could even do that sequence today because, you know, it's a really violent action when, say, the killer starts jamming knives into cadavers, you know? I mean, it's just creepy as heck, you know? It really is. I remember editing it. I don't remember any particular real problems with coverage. We cut to the boots once or twice. I love the end of it where we have the, you know, the blood coming out of the tube. It's all very effective. And Katherine Heigl was I don't know how big of a star she was at that point. But I just didn't, you know, I remember when we did it, I didn't expect that she'd really, even though I read the script, I didn't expect she'd be the one to get it right away, you know. But it was pretty effective. It was very creepy, you know. I think it worked out really well. I mean, you know, you could, if you analyze it, you go, well, wait a minute, how'd she get down those stairs with a mask on? An analytical mind, you look at it two or three times, great. You know, you can question it, and you can talk about it with all your buddies that you went and saw it with, and that's what we want to create in a movie, right? But I think that twist at the end, it was totally believable, and it was a good twist, you know. And he was creepy. I mean, you wanted to hate him, and you thought, oh, okay, well, wait, he's okay. He saved the day. Nice twist. And then you find out, oh, another twist. He didn't save the day. He is a creep, you know. He is the killer. It's really important to keep ahead of your audience, you know, and not be redundant and not beat them over the head with things, you know. And you have to, at the end of the whole day, you have to make sure that you've taken out repeats of dialogue, and you have to make sure that you take out, you know, why have, you know, I look at you, you look at me, I look back at you, you look back at me, you know. You don't need all that, you know. I mean, you can do it a little more expeditiously, and that's what good editing is about. Everybody's a critic now too. I mean try to find a city that you can go preview a picture in where you don't have film students in the audience. It ends up online. People review your movie before you get home, you know. I mean, it's just the way it is. So there is that critical eye. I always joke in the cutting room that, you know, somebody will say, well, geez, look, his button's unbuttoned here and not there. And that'll be an AFI student who will pick that out somewhere years down the line and probably get kudos for seeing it, you know. I mean, the one thing I can say about previews, oops, I'm turned. Previews for horror genre films is that they are always lower than, you know, rom-coms and straight action pictures. And I know when we did, I don't even know if I should say what numbers were on certain pictures, but when we did I Know What You Did Last Summer, the highest mark we got on that was a 64. And it went on and was pretty successful. So, you know, I know the industry standard has evolved as well, and they have a number for everything now. You know, it's not just like, was it scary? What was your favorite scene? I mean, they take each actor, each scene, they put a number to everything, and they really dissect it. And, you know, but they all have different standards in terms of how high will a horror picture score at its best, versus how well will a rom-com score at its best, or, you know, an action picture, or just a straight drama. They're all different, you know, so. I actually don't go see my movies after they've been released. I'm next, I move ahead, you know, and I've got all of them in my library, you know, in different form. Some of them are still in VHS, but, you know, try to get all the DVDs I can. But I just, you know, I just don't go back and look at movies again. Horror pictures, scary movies, I mean, they're fun. They're fun, and it doesn't matter how evolved audiences have got or have become. They still, people get scared, you know. It might take more to scare them because they're just some of the cable, the Netflix, the Amazon, you know, I mean, there's some great stuff on TV. And so, you know, where it was a big event to go to a theater and see a picture like Valentine, now you get on, you can watch, you know, very scary things all the time now, you know. So, you know, I don't know if it's numbed up, but you have to be on your game. There has to be new, better, you know, better ways to do things. You know, I think that for me, what's exciting is that I think that filmmakers aren't going after the cheap scares anymore. Audiences aren't really buying cheap scares where you just throw a big loud noise in there. It's still part of it. When all else fails, you punt and you turn up the volume, you know. But I think, you know, the movies that work for me are movies that have a more psychological drama, you know, or trauma, whichever you want to call it. But you know, I just think that there's always going to be scary movies out there. There just is. You know, I learned a lot on Valentine. like I do on every film, you know, and whatever I've done since then has been an evolvement from what I learned there, and what I was doing there was an evolvement from something I'd done before. What I love about it, and it's not really answering your question, but I walked away from it with a great relationship with a really terrific guy and director, and, you know, I've been friends with Jamie now for, I don't know, 20 years. He introduced me to my wife, who's, when I went over to visit him, and I was a single guy, I went over there to Australia and visited him and hung out, and he had a little barbecue to, like, party where it was, he was introducing me to people in the film community in Melbourne, and there was a girl there that I met that, you know, I mean, I was only there for a few weeks, and we didn't really hit it off or anything, and I ended up doing another picture there about a month later, which would have been my first picture. It was another horror picture, and it was a first-time director, and I wasn't that keen on doing it, and then they said, that's in Melbourne. I said, yeah, all right, let me read the script, and I did, and then I thought it was okay, and but I went back because I had just come back from my first trip over to Australia. And hooked back up with this girl and through Jamie's introduction, and ended up getting married 2 years later. So we've been fast friends, and we stay in touch, and, you know, I'll know him and love him till the day I die.
Yeah. So Jamie's your Cupid, basically.
He is my Cupid. That's kind of scary.
Yeah.
I'll have to watch. If I see some guy in a trench coat with a mask on and a bow and arrow, I'm going the other way.